we come to chapter 6, it's going to be a little bit like chapter 5 was, in that it begins with the record of a miracle of Jesus, followed by a long discourse. And, of course, John is different than the Synoptic Gospels in this respect, that he wants to focus more on what Jesus said about theological issues than really focusing on the specific, a very extensive catalog of Jesus' activities. Also, the teachings of Jesus in John are different than those in the Synoptics, in that the Synoptic Gospels record mainly his moral teachings in parables. Moral teachings and parables. That's kind of two different things you find in the Synoptics. He taught about the kingdom of God in parables, and he taught, of course, in places like the Sermon on the Mount, about how to be righteous and how to live morally. You don't really have that kind of teaching in the Gospel of John. John's the record of Jesus' sermons in John don't contain any parables, unless one would take the Good Shepherd or the vine as a parable. But they're not really, strictly speaking, parables, because they start with "I am the," and the parables of Jesus in the other Gospels are always a certain man did this, a certain person did that, more generic. So he doesn't have any of his normal types of parables here. In chapter 5, there might have been something like a short bit of a parable in what we call the parable of the apprentice son, which said the son doesn't know how to do anything except what he sees his father do, and so forth. That is kind of a parable. It runs for about a verse and a half, and then he makes an application. So it's a very different style of teaching here in John. And the discourses are long and theological in John. In Matthew, Mark, and Luke, the discourses are not usually long, and when they are, they're not usually very theological. They're usually, as I said, moral teaching, practical teaching. So John has filled in gaps that the other Gospels have left out. But one thing that John has included that the other Gospels include is the story of the feeding of the 5,000, and that's what we encounter here at the beginning of chapter 6. It is the only miracle that is recorded in all four Gospels. And that's really amazing, since John was present at almost all the miracles recorded in the other Gospels, and yet he recorded very few of the miracles in general, and only one of the miracles that the other Gospels recorded, which basically sort of proves our point that John was not trying to duplicate, but rather to supplement what the other Gospels had already given us. But one thing he does is tell us what the other Gospels do not. They all tell us about the feeding of the 5,000, but none of the others tell us about the discourse that arose the next day, and what some people have called the collapse of his Galilean campaign. Now, John has told us very little about the Galilean campaign up to this point. The Synoptic Gospels are almost entirely about the miracles and travels and teachings and conflicts that Jesus experienced in Galilee during what's called his Galilean ministry. John has said almost nothing about it, about the Galilean ministry. Not that he has ignored it. In chapter 4, he mentioned that Jesus went to Galilee, and that was the beginning, in fact, of the Galilean ministry, though as far as details go, he only told us one miracle there, and that was the healing of the nobleman's son. And then he's got Jesus going back to Jerusalem immediately in chapter 5 for a feast. And everything we've seen so far that Jesus has done in John's record has been in Judea, except for the turning of water into wine in chapter 2 and the healing of the nobleman's son at the end of chapter 4. John has ignored all of the activity of Jesus in Galilee, which was the entire focus of the other Gospels. But when he comes to this particular story of the feeding of the 5,000, it is apparently important enough theologically for John to include it, even though the other Gospels have already included it. He almost deliberately avoids duplicating what the other Gospels include. But we do have here the feeding of the 5,000, and we might add, as part of the same story, the walking on the water. That is, of course, another miracle that is included in some of the other Gospels, not all. So, why then does he break his normal procedure and duplicate what the other Gospels have said? Clearly, we would have to say it is because he could not bring himself to leave this out. It must have been significant enough, and no doubt, primarily because of the sermon that it occasioned the next day, which he spends more time presenting than he spends presenting the miracle itself. But just as there was a miracle at the beginning of John 5, which gave rise to a monologue that Jesus gave about his relationship with his Father, so now there's a miracle that gives rise to another important theological monologue. It says, after these things, Jesus went over the Sea of Galilee, which is the Sea of Tiberias. And by the way, it's called by both terms, but it's also called by others. It's called, there are a variety of names by which this body of water is called. In most of the Gospels, we have it called the Sea of Galilee. Here he calls it also the Sea of Tiberias. There are other names as well. Tiberias was the name of one of the Caesars, and a city had been built on the west shore of this lake and called Tiberias after the Caesar, and so sometimes the sea was called the Sea of Tiberias. Then a great multitude followed him because they saw his signs which he performed on those who were diseased. And Jesus went up on a mountain, and there he sat with his disciples. Now, he's crossed over the Sea of Galilee to the eastern shore, in the northern region, in the area of Bethsaida, which was the hometown of Philip and Nathanael. We're told that in chapter 1. And this is the area that we today would call the Golan Heights. We all have heard the term the Golan Heights, even if we're not very familiar with the geography over there, because the Golan Heights are often in the news because of disputes over who really should control them. But that's where Jesus was. He was in control of them at this point. And there was a great multitude following him who were willing to give him control of the whole country. As we shall find by verse 15, they're ready to take him by force and make him king, which was something he was not open to. And we might speculate, without much risk of being mistaken, that the crowds already had something like this in mind, even before this particular miracle. I mean, this great multitude that followed him had expectations that the Messiah was going to come soon, and that he would deliver the people of Israel from the oppressor, Rome. But how so many people got gathered in one place at one time is not made very clear. It says they gathered because they saw the signs that he performed on those who were diseased. In other words, they saw healings. And he'd been doing that throughout Galilee for some months prior to this. We just have not had record of it in John's Gospel. But we have record of it in the other Gospels. And so there was a lot of miracles of various kinds Jesus had done in Galilee and therefore had a lot of popular appeal. But in Mark's Gospel, it tells us that this particular miracle happened on the heels of an outreach where he had sent his 12 out two by two to various villages and gave them authority to cast out demons and heal the sick and even raise the dead. And they'd gone out on that outreach and done those things. And when they returned, he said, well, let's go apart for a while away from the crowds. And that's what they were endeavoring to do when he crossed the Sea of Galilee on this occasion, to get away from the crowds. Obviously, he did not succeed. But the crowds were somewhat inflated, perhaps by the fact that the disciples had just been out in all the villages doing these miracles and preaching the kingdom of God, and the people's expectations were up, this is the kingdom of God, it's coming, the Messiah must be around the corner, maybe he's here, and they'd heard about Jesus' miracles, they saw the miracles of the disciples, it looked like something exciting was happening. And so, because of the disciples having been to all these villages and preached there just in the immediate precedent to this, there were lots of crowds that come out of these villages to hear and see Jesus. And as I said, we should not be surprised if they already were considering that this movement, which had so much power, was that of the Messiah, and that this was the king that Moses and the prophets had spoken of. This was, of course, the view of the disciples already. In fact, it was the view of Philip, or I should say of Andrew, when he first met Jesus. He went and found his brother, Simon Peter, and said, you know, we found him of whom Moses and the prophets spoke, Jesus the Messiah. So it didn't take the disciples, most of them, long to reached the conclusion that Jesus was the Messiah, and that's no doubt how these people were thinking. But the disciples and the crowds all were very much unaware of what the actual mission of the Messiah would be. They had their own ideas. And for the most part, they thought he'd be another David, another conquering general, who would, like the judges of the past, or like David in his time, would lead Israel to victory against those Gentiles who'd been oppressing them for so long. And the Jewish people could certainly, you know, appreciate that prospect. They definitely were eager to see themselves being independent people again. They had never really been independent since the Babylonian exile. Although they did return from the Babylonian exile, they did so as vassals of the Persian monarch. And then when Persia fell to the Greeks, they were under the Greek control. And when the Greek kingdom divided, they became sort of a tennis ball batted back and forth between the powers of Egypt and Syria to the south and north of them, respectively. They were always under one or the other of these foreign powers. Then came the Romans and conquered the region. There was only a very short period of time in there where the Jews actually had some independence, and that was after the Maccabean revolt. They overthrew the Syrian power, but they never really established their own monarchy, not legitimately. They had some priests who forced themselves into political power, but it was a mess, and there were intrigues and assassinations and things like that. And there was this temporary independence they had just from the time of the Maccabean revolt until the coming of the Romans from about 168 BC to about 70 BC. And then the Romans came in, and so the Jews were strictly under the heel of Gentile power again, as they were when Jesus came. They were getting sick of it. It had been about almost 600 years since they'd had a truly independent state under a Jewish monarch. And that's what they wanted. That's what the Messiah was supposed to be. And they were certainly thinking, this is now a good time for the Messiah to be here, and this man is a good candidate. But they were hoping that he might mobilize an army, and certainly 5,000 men, and this is what it really appeared here on this occasion, 5,000 men. And Matthew's parallel says, not counting women and children. And, of course, if you add to the number of men, probably an equal number of women, and probably some children in the crowd, too, maybe as many as men, maybe as many as adults. There could have been 15 to 20,000 or more people in this crowd, a very large multitude, and one that would have promise. If a man wished to start a popular revolt against Rome, he had a pretty good seed crowd here. And that's exactly what the people, by the end of the story, wanted to happen. Now, Jesus, on the other hand, had crossed the lake to avoid the crowds. When the disciples had come back from their outreach, he felt it was time for them to have a little bit of rest. And he wanted some time alone with his friends. So they crossed the sea, but the people actually saw where he was going. It doesn't say so here, but the synoptics tell us that the people saw him and his disciples take off in the boat and made mental calculations of what direction they were going and where they're likely to land. So they went around the northern end of the sea, or the lake, and came around and got there before the boat did. So that when Jesus got there, he saw the multitudes, although that's exactly what he's trying to avoid. But it says in Matthew that when he saw them, he had compassion on them. Instead of saying, you know, why don't you guys just leave me alone for a little while? That's why I'm looking for some R&R, some peace and quiet. Instead, he sees their hunger, he sees their need, and it says in Matthew that he had compassion on them because he saw them as sheep lacking a shepherd. And so he taught them and healed them. That's what was going on. Not all of that is recorded in John, but that's filling in the gaps here. Here we simply read that he went up on a high mountain and he sat with his disciples, and it was now the Passover, a feast of the Jews, was near. It would appear this Passover, Jesus might not have gone to Jerusalem. The Jewish men were supposed to go to Jerusalem for the Passover and Pentecost and the Feast of Tabernacles. But apparently it became considered to be more or less optional, probably from the time of the Babylonian exile on. Because once the temple was destroyed in 586 BC and the Jews were in Babylon for 70 years, obviously they had broken the habit of going three times a year to Jerusalem. They didn't have that option. And then once the remnant came back, most of the Jews were still in exile. And many of them made the trip as often as they could to Jerusalem for the festivals, but they obviously couldn't be expected working people with jobs and families couldn't travel across the Mediterranean from Rome every 3 times a year. I mean, some people fly that often or more, but you couldn't really do that and maintain a life if you lived across the continent. And so it was more or less optional these days for Jews to go to Jerusalem. But people who lived in Palestine usually would do it unless they were impious. Jesus, we read of going to Jerusalem at least 2 Passovers that are on record. The first one in chapter 2, and the last one was the one in which he died. But even then, that last Passover, before Jesus appeared publicly, the people in Jerusalem were saying, "What do you think? Do you think he'll come to the Passover?" Like it wasn't necessarily the case that he would. In fact, his own brothers on that occasion, in John chapter 7, urged Jesus to go to the feast, and he indicated he wasn't necessarily going to go up right then, and gave the impression to them that he might not go at all. Here, it was Passover, but he's quite far from Jerusalem, and we don't have any record that he went shortly after this to Jerusalem. So, what telling us that it's Passover simply tells us it's springtime, March or April. And that is just a detail that John remembers from being an eyewitness. This story is full of eyewitness details, some of which are not found in the other Gospels. For example, he's going to make reference to how the abundance of green grass in the area. Well, they're in the wilderness, but that time of year it was not desert-like. You know, in springtime it had a lot of green grass. Just a month or two later, it'd be all dry. But there are these little touches of detail that would be the reminiscences of someone who was there and could still remember the lush green grass in the area. Something not necessary to the story, but just something someone who was there might recall. And Jesus lifted up his eyes and seeing the great multitude coming toward him, he said to Philip, "Where shall we buy bread that these may eat?" Now the synoptic gospels tell us that the disciples came to Jesus. And there's much more detail there because they say the reason this came up, it tells us in Mark that the people had been listening to Jesus teach all day. There's no mention of that here. It just tells us that Jesus looked up and decided to feed them. But they had actually been with him all day. He'd been teaching them, and they'd been being healed of sicknesses, but they apparently had not brought food with them. And Jesus didn't have enough to feed them. And the disciples came to Jesus and said, "Send these people away so that they can go get food." And the synoptics tells us that Jesus turned back to the disciples and said, "You give them something to eat." And then we have the response that is here attributed to Andrew saying, "Well, it would take 200 denarii to feed all these people even a little bit." Now, this actually reads a little differently, the sequence. The other Gospels have Jesus coming to the disciples coming to Jesus to suggest that he should send them away to get food. Here we have Jesus sort of initiating the suggestion to Philip. Where are we going to get food for these people? Now, this is not a contradiction. We could see easily that both of these things could have been part of the conversation. At one point, the disciples figure it's late, we haven't had any time alone, these people haven't eaten, this is a good time to close the meeting, let the people go home and eat, send them away. And they might well have come to Jesus about that initially. And in response to that suggestion, he could have just turned to Philip and said, "Where can we get food?" After all, they were near Bethsaida, that was his hometown, Philip's hometown. You know, what restaurants are good around here, you know? Where do you buy food around here for multitudes? And yet he didn't really expect an answer. It says that he said this to test Philip, because he himself knew what he would do. So Jesus already had a plan to feed these people, and he knew how it was going to be done. But he was testing Philip's faith. And probably Philip should have said what Ezekiel said. When he saw the valley of dry bones, and the angel said to him, "Can these bones live?" Well, the truth is, it didn't look much like they could. But the question begins to raise, the possibility. Well, I don't want to say no, and it doesn't look like I could say yes. And so, what did Ezekiel say? "Sir, you know." And likewise, John, when he was caught up in Revelation chapter 7, he saw this great multitude with the palm branches. One of the elders said, "Who are these people here?" And John said, "Sir, you know." And that's probably what Philip should have said. Lord, you know. Instead, Philip indicated that it wasn't possible, which was probably failing the test. We're told that Jesus was testing him, but he essentially did not believe it could be done. Philip said, 200 denarii worth of bread is not sufficient for them, that every one of them may have even a little. Now, this statement is attributed to the disciples in general in the other Gospels. Here we're told it was Philip that made the statement. So that again, it's another eyewitness detail. John remembers this conversation and with which of the disciples it was initiated. Now, 200 denarii, how much money is that? Back in the King James days in 1611, they translated a penny, 200 pennyworth. But obviously with inflation and so forth, the word penny, first of all, is very inadequate to express the amount of money that this was talking about. And no matter what amount would be translated now, it would change with inflation. So the translators do well to simply leave it untranslated, 200 denarii. One thing we do know is that in the parable that Jesus told of the workers in the vineyard, each one was paid a denarius for a day's labor, and that apparently was the standard wage for a day laborer. So one denarius would be a day's wage, not for the rich people, but for the working class. I don't know what a day's wage would be now for the poorer sorts of people, I guess whatever minimum wage is. Of course we don't have as long days either, but I suppose, what does a minimum wage work for? What's minimum wage out? $8.50? So $8 for 8-hour day, $60-something. That'd probably be sort of the equivalent of a denarius in that time. And 200 of them would be about 8 months' worth. So Philip was saying, and he did these mental calculations rather quickly, and he probably underestimated, because 200 denarii would be only the wages, a day's wages for 200 people. There were 5,000 plus women and children there. So it's probable they really couldn't even buy enough for all the people, even to have a little, as he said, for the amount he suggested. But it sounded like a lot of money to him, and they obviously didn't have the money. He didn't say there's nowhere around here where you could buy that much food, but that might have been true also. Philip was probably thinking more in terms of what it would cost them if they took on that responsibility. He said, we couldn't even give everyone more than just a little bit of food, even if we had 8 months' worth of wages to spend on it, which of course they did not. One of his disciples, Andrew, Simon Peter's brother, said to him, there is a lad here who has 5 barley loaves and 2 small fish. But what are they among so many? Now, the fact that there are 5 loaves and 2 fishes is mentioned in the other Gospels too, but there's details here that aren't in the other Gospels. John alone tells us that it was Andrew that discovered this cache of food. And it's only John that tells us that it was a young boy who had brought the food. In the other Gospels, it just says we have here 5 loaves and 2 fishes. But only here we read that they're stealing a kid's lunch. Actually, he must have volunteered it. And so Andrew says, someone's come up with a little food here, but it really isn't much. Can't really do much with it. 5 loaves and 2 fishes. And fishes, these are not the kind of fish that would make an entree. These are more like sardines. In fact, the other Gospels for fish use the word ichthus, which may be a word you may be familiar with from the little fish stickers that we put on bumpers and things like that. And the Greek letters in there spell ichthus. Ichthus literally means a little fish in Greek. And John uses a different word that's more specific. He actually uses the word for a certain species of fish, which is like a little tiny fish that you would dip in some kind of sauce and eat it, sort of like sardine size. So they had 2 little tiny fish. And the loaves they had were not like our loaves of bread. They were like, muffin size. They were like rolls, barley, cheap barley rolls. And so they had 5 of those and 2 little fish. And so Andrew says, well, this is all we've been able to come up with. Now, I don't know how he came up with it. I don't know if he put out an appeal that we don't read about, asking anyone have any food here, and only the boy volunteered. But somehow Andrew knew what the limits were of what the resources were on hand, and he said, that's just not going to be enough for what we need. We have too many people. Then Jesus said, make the people sit down. Now there was much grass in the place, so the men sat down, in number about 5,000. And Jesus took the loaves, and when he had given thanks, he distributed them to the disciples, and the disciples to those sitting down, and likewise of the fish, as much as they wanted. Now, it doesn't say, we have this mental picture of how this happened, although it's really hard to picture how it happened. Yeah, all it says, he took the food and he distributed it to the people. In some of the Gospels, talks about how he broke them. And we have to almost imagine that as he broke the food, you know, the pieces were, that he broke, in the halves were as big as the original, so he kept, was able to do it so the food multiplied. We're not really told how he multiplied the food, or how, what this would have looked like to anyone watching. You know, that movie they came up with, the Gospel of John, I was interested to see how they portrayed it. And they brought him this basket with these fish and bread in it, and he holds it up and he turns around, he comes back around and he's got a basket full of bread, and it just shows him supplying baskets. But really, that's all the Gospel of John tells us. All it says is he distributed the food. It doesn't really say anything. It doesn't even say he performed a miracle. It just says he distributed the food, the five loaves and the two fishes. But of course, we recognize this as a miracle of multiplication because, as Andrew said quite correctly, you could not even begin to feed the number of people with that amount of food unless it was increased. Now, there are people who are always trying to find naturalistic explanations of the miracles of Jesus. Don't know if you're aware of that. There are theologians who are of a more naturalistic mindset, who actually don't even believe in miracles, and therefore they, assuming that these stories did have some kind of historical basis, try to explain how they could have happened without there being any genuine miracle. And so what they often will say is that all these people who had come to hear Jesus speak had brought their food with them, but they realized there were a lot of other people around them who might want their food if they pulled it out. So they were hiding it. They were hiding their lunch under their robes. And so nobody was eating, and everyone appeared to be without food because no one wanted to bring out their food lest someone else would want some of it. They didn't want to share. And then when they saw this young boy surrender his whole lunch, it just inspired them. And they all started pulling through, well, if he could do it, I guess I can too. So they started pulling out their food, and suddenly there was enough food for everybody. Now that would be moving, that would be inspiring, you know, that would be wonderful, but it wouldn't be what's described. This says that Jesus distributed the food. It does not say that people got out their food and started sharing it with each other. Furthermore, it will say that the people saw this as a miracle. And while we might figuratively say it's a miracle when stingy people become generous, it's not the kind of miracle that causes the reaction that these people had to Jesus. Furthermore, it would be the little boy's generosity, not Jesus, that inspired the miracle, so to speak. So Jesus wouldn't really have any reason to get any credit for what was done. Everyone should be honoring the little boy. You have cured us of our selfishness and our stinginess. Anyway, nothing about the telling of the story really fits that scenario. Although a story like that could happen, it's not the story that's here described. And so they ate as much as they wanted. So when they were filled, he said to his disciples, gather up the fragments that remain so that nothing is lost. So when they started out, they didn't have enough for everybody, but then everybody ate as much as they want and were filled. And then they said, well, there's some extra left over. Let's go gather that up so we don't waste anything. Now you might think if there's ever any food that would be no tragedy to waste, it'd be food that came so freely as that. You know, if you got to work hard for your food and you paid money for it, you'd say, I don't want to waste any of this because that's my hard-earned food. But this is food that kind of came supernaturally without anyone working except Jesus, you know, distributing. It was free food. So who cares if, you know, it just gets left out and wasted? Well, Jesus cared. He was a good economist. He didn't want to take miracles for granted even. You know, food is important stuff. There's people starving. We don't want to waste it. And so they gathered it up, and that was important because it gave evidence of how much surplus there was. And it just so happened to be there were 12 baskets full of what they gathered. Therefore they gathered them and filled 12 baskets with fragments of the 5 barley loaves which were left over by those who had eaten. Perhaps no fish were left over. But the 12 baskets, the number 12, certainly is suggestive. Either that it meant that each of the disciples got a large lunch as well after they were done distributing to the others. You know, that is a possible meaning that we're supposed to take from this. That the disciples were not able to eat first. They were busy serving. Jesus took the food, gave it to his disciples, and they gave it to people. Well, I've been on an airplane before where a couple of flight attendants are serving, you know, 150 people. And I wonder, it looks like a lot of work to them. But I see afterwards they're in the back, they're having their food later. But they have to wait until they've served everybody else. If it was 5,000 people, 5,000 men, plus women and children, that's a big catering job. And 12 guys doing it all themselves, they were probably pretty exhausted. They probably hadn't had time to eat themselves as they were passing out food and making sure everyone had some. So after they had been served, they got a whole basket each for themselves, and that's their reward. But they had to serve others before they got to eat themselves. And it says, then those men, when they had seen the sign that Jesus did. Now this is said to be something Jesus did, not something the little boy did. The people were not inspired by the little boy's generosity, they were inspired by what Jesus did. And it was one of the signs, same word that's used throughout the Gospel of John for the miracles that Jesus did. They said, this is truly the prophet who is to come into the world. Now, the prophet who is to come into the world, we've already seen, has been mentioned back in chapter 1, when the delegation from the Pharisees came from Jerusalem to question John the Baptist. Their first question was, are you the Messiah? And he said, no. And they said, are you Elijah? And he said, no. And then they said, are you the prophet? And they meant the same thing that these people mean when they say the prophet who was to come into the world. Obviously a reference to Moses' prediction in Deuteronomy 18:18 that God would raise up another prophet like Moses. And you know, the book of Deuteronomy closes after telling of Moses' death, it says, since then, there has arisen no prophet like unto Moses. So Deuteronomy leaves the reader, in fact, the whole book of the law, the whole Torah, closes with a statement of an unfulfilled promise. Deuteronomy 18 says, God will raise up a prophet like unto Moses. And he says, to him shall all you people hearken. And anyone who does not, I will require it of him. Or as it says in the Septuagint, whoever does not listen to the words of that prophet shall be cut off from the people. That's how it's quoted by Peter in Acts chapter 3, quoting the Septuagint. So this prophet that would come, that Moses predicted, was one that would be absolutely mandatory for the people to listen to. If they did not, they'd be cut off from the people. That means if a Jewish person did not follow this prophet, he would no longer be part of Israel. He'd be cut off from the people. Therefore, after the coming of that prophet, Israel would be defined by those who are following that prophet. Because anyone who didn't would be cut off from Israel, even if they were Jewish by birth. So Israel suddenly becomes redefined by the coming of that prophet to mean those who follow this prophet. Right? So Deuteronomy contains that prediction and then closes in its final words with the statement, since Moses has died, there has arisen no prophet like unto Moses. And so the book of the Torah, the 5 books of Moses, they close with this statement of deficiency, this statement of something that's expected that has not yet arrived. And so the Jews looked for this prophet. Now we know from what the New Testament teaches us that that prophet is the same person as the Messiah, because Jesus is that prophet and Jesus is the Messiah. The rabbis didn't necessarily equate the two. Now, in the popular mind, the average Jew might have, because the rabbis had a lot of different ideas about Messiah, but many of them had distinctive roles for the prophet who would come on the one hand, and the Messiah who would come on the other hand, and Elijah on the other hand. That's why they asked John all 3 questions. Are you the Messiah? No. Are you Elijah? No. Are you the prophet? No. The scholarly Jews thought of these as different individuals. At least most of them seem to. However, you know very well that even in our day, where all Christians have Bibles, they all can be very confused about what the eschatology is, even that which is accepted by their denomination, if they haven't heard it taught clearly, or if they've just never, you know, become acquainted with it. Even Christians can read their own Bible and be confused about Christian eschatology. So Jews who didn't have Bibles to read, who were mostly peasants, illiterate probably, and if not illiterate, at least didn't have access to Bibles to read them, they might well not be very familiar with the details of their rabbi's eschatological outlook. And they might have, in their own minds, equated the prophet that Moses predicted would come with the Messiah. To them, they might have had it all mixed together. And if they did, then they accidentally got it right, because that's what turned out to be the case. Jesus was the prophet, and he was the Messiah. It was the same person after all. And that may be how the people thought, because they said, truly, this is the prophet who is to come into the world. And the verse next says, therefore, when Jesus perceived that they were about to come and take him by force to make him king, he departed again to a mountain by himself alone. Now, they could hardly desire to take him by force to make him king unless they were seeing him as the Messiah. Because to do so would be viewed as such a revolutionary act by the Romans that unless he turned out to be the Messiah, it would be squashed in a bloody massacre.